A top, na top, na top means falling down in drops. To speak by inspiration, by the spirit of revelation, shining forth those hidden treasures from God's word.
Okay, I was saying we're going to talk about some more presses in Israel. I'm not going to show any more pictures of them. I'm just going to tell you about them. But they have found a lot of the stone presses in Israel. There was even one found in Jerusalem we'll mention later. And I've got quite a few pictures of all the presses in my trips. But they show that the importance of the oil in Bible times, olive oil in Bible times, how important it was. But they found a basin dug in a clay layer in the near the seashore of Mount Carmel. And there in that basin was a pit, and it was full of olive pits and organic matter. So they knew that it had been used as a olive press. And it was produced there in an ancient method that they called Shaman Rachutz. And that was the traditional method that they used at that time. But whether ancient or modern, essentially, the oil extraction involves seven processes that we're going to talk about. In seven stages, however you want to say it, that was washing, pressing, crushing, separating oil from the water, gathering and storing and distributing. And taking number one, washing, they had to wash and clean these olives because there might be some contamination on them, because the soil could get contaminated and contaminate the olives, and it could give a bad flavor or even possibly make someone sick. So they had to be cleaned real good. The second stage was pressed. They had to be pressed or crushed by an external device to separate this fleshy fruit from the oil that was inside of it. And that was done by a large stone, as I showed earlier. It's called a mimel. The large stone was called a mimel, and it would crush the olive in the pulp. That's the thing about it. I really think this is spiritual, because the flesh of this olive had to be crushed. Had to be pressed. And you know, before the anointing can flow from us, we've got to be pressed. We've got to be crushed in spirit, and sometimes even in our flesh. In other words, for God's anointing to be able to flow out of us, and I'm talking about those who are born again. So I think it's a picture of God's people and the anointing that can come from them. After seeding, the first pure oil, in other words, the first pressing that's done is where the purest oil comes from. And it's dipped out. And then the third stage is the pulp is placed in baskets with holes in it, and it's crushed beneath two stones, or between two stones, to release its oil. And then it's flows into the vats, and then it's gathered, which I'll talk about in a minute. But this was virgin oil. And it was the very first pressing was the purest extra virgin olive oil, and the second crushing or pressing is the virgin oil that you get. And any processing later, in other words, any crushing after that produces lesser and lesser grade of oil. And so it's the first and the second grade of oil that are the purest and the finest, but especially the first. And it was the first grade that God told them to use in the tabernacle when they were, you know, going to use it in the tabernacle. But the latter screw press that I mentioned was often the means for the second pressing, the first pressing. While the two round stones were used for crushing, they would often add water and mix with these olives when they went the second round to bring out this oil, because it helped to bring the oil out. And it kind of reminds me of Jesus or Yeshua when he was talking to the chief priest in Matthew, and we're going to read that next. Matthew 21:42-44. Jesus said unto them, Did you never read in scriptures, The stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner? This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. Now, this Yeshua was talking to these chief priests here, And he was basically, in essence, trying to tell them something. He was letting them know that he was that stone, that cornerstone, and that they were not allowing him. They weren't receiving him. And he was letting them know that the stone, when it falls, when if you fall on the stone, of course, you're going to get hurt if you fall on a stone. But if a stone falls on you, it's going to crush you. And I think he had in mind either the grapes or the olives one when he was doing this, because grapes were also crushed. They had to be crushed to get the juice out. But I think more so than he may have been thinking about the olive, because for the fact that the olive is where the anointing comes from. But whether it was, he may have been thinking of both, the olive and the grape, as he was talking about it, because you need the oil and the wine, according to the scriptures, the oil and the wine of the Spirit. But to get the oil, like I said, they had to be crushed and water had to be added. And the water represents the Spirit of God. So can an anointing come without the washing of the water by the Word? No. We have to be washed by the water of the Word. We have to be crushed. And in order for that oil, the anointing, the oil of the Holy Spirit anointing to come to us. And the Bible says, out of the belly shall flow rivers of living water. So the stones bring forth the oil and the wine. But the stones crush both the olives for oil and the grapes for wine. And when the oil and the wine is brought forth, we see, according to the man that was on the road to Jericho and he was injured, and the man comes along and he pours in oil and wine, and it helps to begin to heal this man. And we know that the Spirit of God, through the oil of the Spirit and the wine of the Spirit, that's it has healing power for people. The anointing is healing, and the wine, which represents joy, is healing. The Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength. So we need the oil and the wine, but the only way to get those things are to be crushed, to be pressed. And that's the way that we get it. Okay, we talked about the first three steps. That was washing, pressing, crushing. And the next step, number four, is it has to be separated. The water and the trash has to be separated from the oil. The good stuff has to be separated from the water and the trash. The water is what cleans or brings the oil out. And, but in this process, in this step here, it has to be separated from the oil. The trash has to be taken out. And number five, the oil has to be gathered from the vats or the containers where it was, and, where it was pressed and crushed. It has to be gathered and put in, to something, for step number six, where it can be put in containers, for storage. And that's where they have the, in other words, they can't just be, like olive oil, for example. Okay, you can't put olive oil in plastic for very long. I mean, if you put it in a plastic bottle, it gets rank a lot faster than if it's in glass. And so it has to be put into containers where it will last. It's olive oil is not something you can keep a long time. A lot of the other oils you can keep much longer. But olive oil goes rank quicker than some of the others because it needs to be fresh. It needs to be fresh. And that right there has a very spiritual connotation even in that. And then the seventh step is the oil is sold or distributed. And we got to realize that olive oil is mentioned more than 200 times in the Bible. And Hosea 2:8 even says that it is a gift from God. And of course we know that it is, because it represents the greatest gift, one of the greatest gifts, not the greatest, but one of the greatest gifts God gave, and that was the Holy Spirit, the anointing of God. Of course we know that Jesus, when he came to die, was the greatest gift that we could receive, because it brought us salvation. And without salvation, we cannot have the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit and Jesus, Yeshua, are great gifts from the Father, and we need to thank him for those gifts. Okay, now we want to discuss the places that olive wood was used in the Bible. And this won't take very long, but it was used at the cherubim of the temple of the cherubim. It was also used in the inner and outer doors of the temple. In other words, when they made the cherubim, it's really pronounced cherubim, they made them out of olive wood. And when they made the inner and outer doors of the temple, they made them out of olive wood also. Next, we're going to list the seven ways that olive oil is used in the Bible. I'm sure there's probably more ways than that, because I originally had three. But there are seven that I have listed. And That was the first one was they used it for light in ancient Israel. They used it for food, both individually and for offerings. They used it for anointing the officials of the sanctuary. They used it for medicinal purposes. They used it for ointments for the skin. They used it for preparing perfume and cosmetics and for lubricants. So that's the seven ways that I know of. There may be more ways, but that's the ones I know of. But also, the olive tree is one of seven species that are native to Israel. They would call that, well, native means, they call it Sabra. In other words, if you're born in the land, you're called a Sabra. So Jesus or Yeshua would have been known as a Sabra. And he was from the tribe of Judah. And according to ancient rabbis, the tribe of Judah, they likened the tribe of Judah to olive trees. And tradition says that, refers to the olive tree as the tree of light, which I find to be interesting because in John 4, Jesus talks about that he's the light of the world. So the olive tree is referred to as the tree of light. And this will play into significance as I go on with this lesson. So kind of keep that in mind. But it's known as the tree of light. But Yeshua, he is also known as the light of the world. And we're going to read Genesis 28 and 11 and 12, actually. Okay, and he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. Okay, Genesis 28:17-19 says, And he was afraid and said, How dreadful is this place! This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. And Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel or Bethel. But the name of that city was called Luz at the first. And this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that you have given me, I will surely give the tenth unto you. Now the Hebrew words for oil used most often in these scriptures is the word shaman. It's the word that we used in the opening of this teaching. It's used 190 times and in all Bible periods. It means fat, oil, grease, marrow, hence the fattest part, the choicest part, the purest, the best part, in other words, of the oil. Okay. Oil for the light, spices for anointing oil, and for sweet incense. That's Exodus 25 and 6. This was part of the offering that the children of Israel were supposed to bring to Moses when they were doing the tabernacle, and of course they gladly brought this, and there was such an overflow that he had to tell them, stop, don't bring any more, because the people were very generous in the bringing of the things to use in the tabernacle for God. Exodus 27:20 says, And you shall command the children of Israel that they bring you pure oil olive, beaten for the light, to cause a lamp to burn always. This had to be beaten oil, or as we mentioned earlier, pressed, crushed, beaten oil. What it means by this is this oil was made from olives that were beaten or crushed, the very first pressing, in other words. This was the type that they had used, as I mentioned earlier. Exodus 29:1-2 says, And this is the thing that you should do to them, to hallow them, to minister unto me in the priest's office. Take one young bullock and two rams without blemish, and unleavened bread, and cakes unleavened, tempered with oil, and wafers anointed with oil, of wheaten flour shall you make them. Now, this was talking about the priest. Although it mentions the furniture in another verse, I'm not sure it's this verse or the next one that I've got on there. It may be the next one. But anyway, it does mention a verse that I probably won't read, but you can read it as we get there, that's talking about the furniture. But this one's talking about the priest, that they had to anoint them to hallow them or make them holy, are consecrated for the priest office with the oil, and they would have to take these certain offerings as they did this so that they would be consecrated for the office of the high priest or the priesthood.